This is the Tame Aperture podcast.
Open the pod bay doors, please, Hal.
Hello, Hal. Do you read me?
Do you read me, Hal? Do you read me, Hal?
Affirmative, Dave. I read you. I read you. I read you.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
Come on down and jump into this shit.
You'll always have that. Sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
Welcome to the Tame Aperture Podcast, where we talk all things movies from first-time directors, indie films, art house, and much, much more. Today on the podcast, we discuss the 1987 war drama Full Metal Jacket as we kick off our run of episodes highlighting one of the greatest filmmakers of the past century, Mr. Stanley Kubrick. Full Metal Jacket follows a platoon of Marines and one singular Marine known as Joker as they navigate the Vietnam War and the brutal realities that spawn from it. Starring Arlie Ermey, Mathew Modine, and Vincent D'Onofrio, and was co-written and directed by Kubrick himself. The film was released in the United States in the summer of 1987, and Full Metal Jacket received critical acclaim and grossed nearly $120 million, just behind a budget of $16 million with one Oscar nod. I'm Gabe Wienendahl, filmmaker, film instructor, and movie enthusiast, and I'm joined as always by co-host, editor, and veteran podcaster, Mr. Alan Martindale. And tonight we have the pleasure of a special guest, once again, Mr. James Gendreau, our resident movie enthusiast and military veteran. So James, how are you?
I'm doing well. I'm copacetic.
Good. And Alan, how you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm trying to think. Is James, he's our first return guest, right?
Yeah, he is. And rightfully so. We're happy to have him back on.
Thank you.
I think this is fitting, James, to have you on, because I know for a fact I didn't serve in the military, and I'm pretty sure Alan didn't. I'm not sure, though. He can vouch for himself. So it'll be good to have some authenticism in the discussion.
Well, yeah, that too. And plus, we could call it a belated Veterans Day podcast.
Absolutely. Happy belated Veterans Day. Thanks for your service. But these are I'm glad to have you on, because A, Kubrick is my guy. He's my guy when it comes to filmmaking. Alan knows this is long overdue for me. Between Kubrick and the Coen brothers, we've said this before and we made this comparison, Alan. It's Michael Jordan and LeBron James. Like, there's two great players, and the Coen brothers and Kubrick, for me, in my ranking system, that's who they would compare to in a sports analogy. So tell me about James, give me a little bit about your background or what you think about Kubrick or Kubrick films in general, and then we'll get a little more into Full Metal Jacket.
Well, I'm going to avoid sports analogies, unlike last time, because you guys already know how I feel.
Well, we know you're an East Coast or Boston area guy, so we could discuss for hours.
How does that feel? Gordon Hayward bail on you. Doesn't feel so good, does it?
I didn't like the guy, so good riddance.
Hey, at least you got a sign and trade, man. At least you got a sign and trade.
Exactly. But back to Kubrick, I would definitely put him in the top 10 of my favorite movie filmmakers. In fact, I don't think there's a movie he has ever made that I didn't like. So
I concur. Alan, where do you fit on that? That's a great setup for it, James. I agree. I don't think there's a movie he's made that I don't like.
There's a few I haven't seen, I'll admit that, but every one that I have seen, I own. So that tells you that I don't dislike any of his movies.
Tell me which ones, let me guess two of them you have not seen. Let me guess.
Okay.
Barry Lyndon.
Loved it. Own it.
Okay. You've seen Barry Lyndon. Okay. The Killing.
Own it. Loved it.
Geez, which two haven't you seen then?
I haven't seen
Lolita.
I haven't seen that one. That is correct. And I also, believe it or not, have never seen Dr. Strangelove. Believe it or not.
Okay.
That's one of the few that have slipped through the cracks. However, I know this won't surprise you. I'm going to admit this. My favorite of his is Eyes Wide Shut. And it has nothing to do with the orgy scene. Excuse me. But anyway. I digress.
Nothing to do with it.
So, nothing at all.
Nothing at all.
I will also vouch for you on that, though. Maybe not the order, but the movie itself I enjoy. I like Eyes Wide Shut. It's a good one. But I got to go. If I'm going to go my tier, I'm going to say Clockwork Orange, number one.
Great movie. Own it as well.
Alan, where are you at on the Kubrick scale?
Kubrick is he's actually a guy. I'm a little embarrassed to say it. I've never had a deep dive into him until I started doing this podcast. And now I've since watched more Kubrick movies than I did before. Obviously, dude, The Shining is the best. I also like, obviously, Clockwork Orange is fantastic. That one, I think those are my two favorite that I've seen. I haven't seen all of them. I actually had not seen Full Metal Jacket since I was very young. So this was kind of like a new viewing to me.
Well, good. Let's get into the movie a little bit. Let's get right into Full Metal Jacket and tell me a little bit about. So James, this one to me doesn't land in my top three Kubrick films. It's a great movie, but it doesn't land in the top three. I'm curious, for you, the real big question to me, Alan, and I get this a lot when I read reviews about films, and we'll read some here in a little bit when we do the Google review section, but authenticity. This is a big question for me. Having not lived in any military life whatsoever, where do we land on the authenticity scale, James? From your
Well, it's funny you should say that, because my father was a Marine in Vietnam at the closing end of it in the 74-75, and he was a Marine, and he says that, I mean, number one, Full Metal Jacket is probably one of his all-time favorite movies, but only the first half, because he said that the basic training sequence was almost as authentic as something could get for a movie with basic training in the military.
So
he said, from like how my father put it, was from 9 to 10, 10 being most authentic, it was somewhere between like an 8 or a 9 for basic training.
That has a lot to do with Arlie Ermey. No,
correct. I would assume so.
He was born to play that role.
Isn't he great?
Put on this earth to play that role.
Even though he wasn't supposed to be that role in the first place, the door gunner, the one when they remember in the middle of the movie when they're going to Vietnam and the door gunner says he shoots women and children, yep, and they ask him how, and he goes, easy, I just don't lead them as much, which one of the funniest things I've ever heard. But I have a dark sense of humor. That door gunner was supposed to be the drill instructor.
Yeah, they made the right decision. Kubrick.
But they made Arlie Ermey the drill instructor, and then they gave that guy the door gunner job. So
yeah, because originally Ermey was going to be a technical advisor.
Correct. Yes, that is correct.
And I think that bleeds through. I think you can see why. But apparently, absolutely, from some of the research, he kind of vied for the role, pushed Kubrick to kind of audition for it. And what he was able to do, and just improvising a bunch of those lines that you hear throughout, which, by the way, the first 20 minutes of this movie, and I don't know if I was laughing my ass off.
Yeah, same here. The first hour in basic training is some of the funniest stuff I've ever heard in my life. Like, no comedy writer could come up with what Arlie Ermey did, in my opinion. So,
well, he's saying, there's something about, I was thinking about this. So I was trying to think. So we talked about him when we talked about the remake of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre and how he's by far the best part of that movie. And I was thinking about what makes him so goddamn good. And it's not just his performance, because his performance is outstanding in everything he does. But when he's cast in a villain role, he automatically raises the stakes, because you don't have to have memorable protagonists or good characters or people to root for. Just by pitting him against them, you're already going to root for them because he's so fucking scary.
He was even great in Seven, even though he was in it for like 15 minutes.
He was in Seven? I don't remember that.
Yeah, he was the police captain.
Oh, that's right. He was.
Yeah.
Yep. And he's so good.
And that's what makes the first part of this film. This is what I love that Kubrick does, because I was watching this with my wife, and the first 20 minutes, we admittedly were just laughing our asses off. But what he does so good is there's a weird switch in there for me. That first 20 minutes is just that opening speech of him going off and just laying into all these newbies and all these grunts that are coming into the barracks, and like, not the barracks, the training. But just laying into them, and it's so funny and it's so ad lib, and that's what makes it feel even funnier, is the fact that you know he's just improvising half of this stuff.
Yeah, agreed.
Like you said, James, you can't write that. I mean, I guess if you lived it, you could write it, because you could, but even in the way that he delivers it, it'd be tough to write it so funny and articulate.
Agreed.
Even his movements, even the way he walks, it's so like he's shorter than everybody else, but he's so goddamn intimidating. And the way they blocked it and the camera movement. I mean, to me, the first half of this movie, I have not seen everything Kubrick has done, but the first half of this movie is a master at work. Like this is as good as filmmaking gets. Because you think about this, they immediately throw you in to this situation. We don't know. There's no exposition telling where these guys came from. We don't even know their real names for the most of the movie. Like, they're just immediately thrown in there. There's very little score. These characters don't even speak very much other than responding to the drill sergeant. Yet you're still engaged in every second that happens.
True. To be fair, though, there is slight exposition in the beginning of the movie. The country music song that's being played is a country music song about guys going to Vietnam.
Right. But there's no like, I came from a small town in Texas.
Okay. Valid. Okay. I see what you mean now. Yeah.
And to me, it's kind of a metaphor for what it must be like to just be thrown into this military environment when there's a war going on. Like who you were doesn't matter anymore. Mm-hmm. Your past doesn't matter. And so we're kind of, these characters are just thrown into this movie. We don't know who the hell they are. And I don't even care, man. They don't speak. They don't have a personality. But for some reason, Kubrick is able to still keep you engaged in that story for the first half of this movie. It, to me, it's a masterclass in storytelling.
And
going back to the whole blocking thing, if you notice in the first like 20 minutes or so, when he's walking back and forth, his left arm almost never moves, because right before they filmed that, he had broken his wrist. So they had to come up with a way to cover up the cast on his wrist. So he did it while he was walking up and back and forth on the barracks. So only his right arm moves.
And that would explain a little bit about also the cutting style, because editorially, this is one thing I noticed, which was there are very abrupt cuts there from one blocking of a camera position to another. Like a lot of times in filmmaking, you're trying to create a fluid motion of imagery, right? And Kubrick just doesn't give a shit. He's like, here's a medium shot of the sergeant, and then cut into a close. It's just an inline cut. So it just moves the camera forward and it feels unnatural. Did you notice these edit? There's some weird editing at the beginning of this movie, but for some reason he always makes it work. He does this in, he also breaks that 180 degree rule where there's orientation all the time. He did it like the first 20 minutes in the barracks is all editorial broken rules, but it still works for some reason. And I'm not sure, maybe it has to do with what Alan was discussing, which is you immediately get thrown into this world and kind of start wanting to figure out who these people are and who these guys are.
To piggyback on that, and by the way, I might have a lot to say on this because it's my father's, you know, one of his favorite movies. So when he listens to this, I got to show that I have some knowledge on it.
I love it.
But I do know that from my experience and from everybody else, I'm sure, who's been in basic training, when you're basic training, you're fucking thrown into this shit. And, I mean, granted, it wasn't as bad for me when I went through as, you know, the guys in Vietnam, but you're just thrown into this. You don't know anyone, you fucking no friends, nothing. So I'm sure you could get away with the 180, the rule you said, because it's so chaotic.
Yeah, the film grammar doesn't matter, but it's something as a filmmaker that I noticed, but I didn't. Usually you care is what I mean. And for some reason, I didn't care.
Well, for me, like, obviously, you know, as an editor, I kind of notice editing stuff like that. I didn't notice any of that in this movie.
I think if you go watch that first 20 minutes, Alan, just take a look. I think you'll see it, but that's alluding to what we were talking about before. Like, I've seen the movie, you know, three, four times, five times, whatever it is, over the course of my life. And you said this is but just go rewatch that and you'll go, well, he does that all the time. And it's like, however, it's so deliberate. I think you get so drawn into like the principles of how things should be when you're putting together a movie and the composition and the grammar that he just is so good at what he does. He just says, I don't give a shit about any of that.
And he's just on another level. Like I think I could be wrong, and forgive me if I'm mistaken. I think I remember reading somewhere that he has a genius intellect, like his IQ is technically a genius or something along those lines, where at that point your brain just works on a different level and you can't be constrained by the typical rules that are set out, you know, like what you're going to learn in film school.
Yeah. I think I've heard that. I don't know. I can't, like I said, I don't have the research to back it up, but I've heard that he had a pretty high IQ as well. So tell me about, so it gets introduced. They're in the barracks. Of course, there's the drill sergeant, but then, which is Arlie Ermey. And then you have kind of two primary characters, one that is called Joker. That's his name. And then one they call Gomer Pyle.
By the way, Matthew Modine, every time he did that John Wayne thing, I just cringe because it's not good. It's not funny. Like, I don't, why they gave him that kind of thing to cement him as Joker. It's just, and I'm sure there's more if you read into it, you know, American John Wayne type thing, tough guy, but he can't do that impression. We're shit, man. He's so bad at it.
Yeah, it was a bad impression. I mean, I like his character and I think he's a good actor, so he's believable as a Marine to me, the non-military expert. But yeah, his impersonation of John Wayne was atrocious.
I thought he was in this movie. I thought Matthew Modine was very unremarkable in this.
Yeah.
Not that he wasn't bad, but there's nothing like if he wasn't the protagonist, I would never remember his character or his acting job or anything.
And that's what's kind of interesting is that he's not that engaging in a sense that compared to the other characters that come into this movie.
I had read that Anthony Michael Hall and Val Kilmer were both up for the role of Joker and Matthew Modine got it. I just actually read that just before we started this podcast.
That would be a different movie.
So, and I also read that Bruce Willis was up for the role of Private Cowboy and Denzel Washington turned down a role as 8-Ball.
Interesting. So, and we'll get into those characters because they all become pretty pivotal towards the end, especially. But the opening of the film is really kind of centered on the sergeant, Joker, and Gomer Pyle.
That's right.
And it's interesting because in that opening sequence, I mean, it's half the movie. Nothing really happens, but there's still quite an arc that goes on. You know, it's I've been trying to dissect this in my brain ever since I watched this. I don't know why I loved this opening sequence so much, because if you break it down on paper, it shouldn't be good at all.
Yeah. 20 minutes of drill sergeant yelling, 4 minutes of starting to feel a little bit of sympathy towards Pyle's character, 'cause he's just getting shit on by everybody. And he's kind of I don't know if they're trying to build if there's a mental illness to this character in the sense that, is he mentally handicap. I don't know if they were playing into that. I don't know if you guys read into that. I thought maybe that's what he had, some kind of deficiency. No,
for sure. For sure.
It felt like that. So anyways, you sympathize with that character, and then a little bit of Joker kind of encouraging him and kind of getting behind him and giving a little like rah, rah to help him get through, you know, the trouble. And then it just flips because once Gomer Pyle hits, once there's a switch there. I'm trying to, and this is where I wanted to dissect it, Alan, was like the Gomer Pyle seems like because at the opening, he's getting yelled at by the sergeant, getting yelled at, and he's just smiling. He seems like a pretty happy guy, seems like a pretty, you know what I mean, non-confrontational person. And by the
smirk off his face, and he can't stop smiling. It's like, it's perfect. So great.
And then 20 minutes later, he's going to do some serious shit that's completely opposite of who we originally were introduced to, right? What do you think about that, James? What's the deal there?
Well, from my experience and from the experience of my father and other people, the whole smiling and joking by Gomer Pyle when he's first in basic training, that happens to people. They're in that situation and they're like, they can't believe that some guy's job is to just literally yell at the top of their lungs at fucking people. So people sometimes laugh or smile and can't fucking help it. However, I do agree to an extent with mental health, but I don't think he was mentally challenged or anything. However, I do think after the blanket party, he lost it. And that's when he went fucking crazy.
And
he starts talking to his rifle. And then that's the first clue. They're cleaning the bathrooms and he's like, oh, Joker's like, oh, he's talking to his rifle. I think he's Section 8. Section 8 is the military term that you're fucking crazy. So the blanket party is what caused him to lose it.
And for those listening, kind of leading into that blanket party, basically.
Yeah, sorry.
No, that's okay. Basically, Gomer has snuck in a donut into his, what's it called?
Correct.
It's his little container, his little bedside storage unit, whatever. I don't know what they're called.
It's his footlocker.
Thank you. That's the term.
But it's before that too, when they're all seen doing exercises and he's just sitting there and everybody else is doing exercises where they stand up and get in the push-up position and then get back up. They were starting to get punished for his mistakes. So that's what led to the blanket party. And the blanket party, because of his mistakes, is what led to him losing.
Yeah, it was the donut. Well, part of it too was the donut in his footlocker.
Correct.
And getting yelled at, and then everyone doing donuts while the sergeant said, "You're eating the donut, and they're gonna pay for your sins."
Yeah, and they're doing push-ups. Yeah, that was the straw that broke the camel's back. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, now I had a question for you, James. So, at the beginning, I think it's the very first opening sequence, not opening sequence, but in the barracks, when Arlie Ermey's just going up and down and screaming at everybody. And that's when Mathew Modine does his little John Wayne thing out of the blue. Like, to me, does that seem realistic at all? Because when he did that, I'm like, that's the last fucking thing anyone would do in that situation, is just out of the blue do a John Wayne impression. It didn't make sense to me. To me, it didn't fit.
Well, I mean, nothing like that happened when I was in basic. And side note, I do want to say, because people are going to hear this, I'm definitely no expert, you know it all of the military, just my experiences. But no, that never happened to me when I was in basic. Nobody ever said that. But I mean, I don't see it being implausible that some guy who thinks he's funny, who thinks he can get away with stuff and wants to push buttons, would try something like that. So, but I do know this, is that when I was in basic, and even my father said it, there would have been more than just Arlie Ermey for instructors. So there would have been more than one drill instructor in reality.
Right. But they would have been rotating through different.
Yeah, there would have been like three or four of them. So, right. You know, but yeah, it's plausible that some guy thinks he's funny, some smart ass could say that. Yeah. And back then when you were allowed to hit him, absolutely he'd get punched. Nowadays that wouldn't happen, but back then, during the Vietnam era, absolutely.
Putting myself in that position, I just can't imagine that would ever even cross my mind to make a smart ass at that point. It's just stupid.
Yeah, you're just playing with fire, but I don't see it being implausible.
But that's also not against the grain for the Joker or Mathew Modine's character. Like, if you think about him going forward, he's pretty passive-aggressive, confrontational. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
Not in basic, though. Like, he is later. And this is kind of what I had. It felt like a huge disconnect between the first half and the second half of the movie. because he doesn't do anything else like that in Basic. And maybe he just learned his lesson because Arlie Ermey kicked his ass. I don't know, but
more than likely.
He does stand up to him though when he's talking about so he's still a little like rooted in his own thing, because remember when Arlie Ermey's like, "Do you believe in the Virgin, the Mother Virgin, Virgin Mary?"
Yeah.
And he's basically will not admit, and he's forcing him. Arlie Ermey, the drill sergeant's like, just literally just drilling the shit out of him. Like, you will say this, you will believe in this. And he does stand up a little in his own way. And he actually gets a little respect from the drill sergeant by doing so.
Correct.
He's got a little bit in there. You know what I mean? There's still a little bit of like passive. It's a little like a confrontational type of person, you know?
But I also see him getting nicknamed Joker as foreshadowing for the second half, because he continues being that way.
Right. It definitely escalates later on even more so.
When he wears the peace symbol, but then on his helmet it says "Born to Kill."
Yes.
You know?
Yes. But Gomer Pyle goes crazy. He flips a switch, basically. Goes from the laughable kind of cuddly to me, like in the first place, he's kind of a cuddly bear. He's just like a big teddy bear who can't keep up with everybody else. And then kind of basically flips a switch. And before you know it, he's now crazy. He's lost it. Like you said, Section 8, he's gone.
And you can see it happen too. But I want to know what you guys,
Alan, sorry, not you not only, I mean, Kubrick wants you to vividly see it in his classic zoom in jacket.
Yeah.
You know, if you think about The Shining and all his other films, there's a classic zoom into the face and it's a 1,000-yard stare, literally.
Yep, absolutely.
There. And it's a total Kubrick move to do the zoom lens, by the way.
God is in The Shining for sure. It's the
exactly.
same.
Exactly.
But what did you guys think of D'Onofrio? Because I'm watching it and I don't understand why he's not more of a leading man in anything. Like, we don't see him as a protagonist much. We see him kind of as a side character in films, and I don't know why, because everything I've seen him in, I think he's got a weird creepy factor to him.
Yeah, he's creepy as shit once he flips that switch. In terms of like, I can't even name a movie that he's in off the top of my head.
I just know because I watched it a couple weeks ago. He's in Sinister, but he's just kind of a half character, like he's a side character.
Right.
He has a cameo in JFK by Oliver Stone.
True.
He plays one of the assassination witnesses.
It's kind of like token appearances by Vincent D'Onofrio.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think he's good enough to carry a film. I would like to see more of that. Like, he was in that that Law and Order show.
Law and Order.
He is weirdly creepy in that, and he's a cop. You know, he's a good guy in that show, but he's still weirdly creepy. And I just, there's something about him that I want to see more of him on screen.
Yeah, I concur. I thought he was great, and the ability to play that two-sided character, where you're kind of one thing in the first 20 minutes, and then you kind of flip the next 10. And to make it believable that he's going to do what he does, you know, like there's something in the character there that you got to like portray to make it believable that he's actually going to go that far and has lost it that much. And he does do really good at that. Right. Which leads us into that scene. Like, this is crazy. This is where tonally, the whole movie switches.
Yeah, that's it. It becomes, you think it's going to become something that it never does actually. So, and by the way, D'Onofrio in this scene is just chewing the scenery, man. Like, just totally like a rat with a T-bone. Just really love. I mean, there's something about Kubrick. He loves when guys do this. Like, he loves his actors to really ham it up. Because, I mean, you look at Jack in The Shining, great performance. But, man, it's so, like, he chews the scenery like crazy. Malcolm McDowell in Clockwork Orange. Like, this is a Kubrick thing where he's just like, you can't cheese it up too much for him.
But it works.
It works totally. But some of the line delivery in this scene, I was like, man, because I knew it was going to happen, because obviously it's a very famous scene. It's like, man, it just doesn't really fit what is about to go down. But maybe it's just I knew the outcome.
I was watching with my wife. She's never seen it. She doesn't. And she, as soon as he starts staring, she's like, this, because the first 20 minutes of, this is what I mean, the first 20 minutes of the film, you're laughing your ass off. I was. And then this happens and my wife goes, this doesn't turn out to be a happy film, does it? And then 4 minutes later, there's a murder suicide. Right. D'Onofrio kills the drill sergeant and then kills himself.
And then it's never spoken of again.
No, but what it, and I, it, yeah, it doesn't come into play on the surface, but it does tonally change the film.
Yeah.
Because the tone of the first 20 minutes is not that at all to me. And then all of a sudden now it's tonally changed. And now we have more of a dramatic piece, because the first 20 minutes in my mind, literally could be a comedy. 100%.
Here's what I thought. I would agree.
I want to know what your thoughts are. See, to me, it was, I didn't find it overtly funny, which is kind of weird because I love Arlie Ermey and he makes me laugh every time I see him. I didn't really laugh. I was just kind of enthralled by everything that was happening and it felt real. And then as soon as this scene happens, then I'm like, okay, well, all the realism is gone for me now. Like, now I can't trust anything that the film is going to show me later on. And it also kind of peaked with the violence, because that was traumatic. Seeing that was very traumatic. It was done incredibly realistic. It was shot very, very, very traumatic. And then after that, it's like nothing, even the climax of the film was not as shocking to me as this. So to me, it peaked a little early.
Yeah, I can see where you're going with that. You see, you know, getting that dramatic beat out of the way really fast. And it is filmed exceptionally well. Like, it feels very authentic. It felt real to me. And you do feel it. I did. And the shift in the emotionality of everything changed when he... And you empathize too, right?
Oh,
like it's like a scene where you're like, and I kind of disagree from the perspective of like the first 20 minutes, Alan, to me, I literally could chalk it up to a fucking comedy. It was so, I was laughing my, I say it three times now, I'm laughing my ass off at the things this guy was saying. I was in awe that he could even come up with shit like this. I don't even know how you come up with that off the top of the dome so quickly, and it made me laugh so hard. And so, but I see what you're saying. You get a peak of emotional distress early on within the first 30 minutes, and then it's a shift. But I think totally, it's just like, I think they leave it because that's the reality of the situation. Like, there's nothing more to say. The character, like, we don't, do you know what I mean? Because this is what they're going to experience going forward. These kind of traumatic events and the things that, especially the Vietnam War, from stories that we hear, brought to soldiers and to kids, that I call them kids because they were young, the things that they were going to see and experience, that was just a precursor to all of that.
Oh, absolutely. And that's, to me, that's why I love this scene. Don't get me wrong. And I think I'm glad it's in the movie. But for me, I thought at first, the first half of the movie, for first 50 minutes, I'm sitting there thinking that I'm going to get a very realistic portrayal of the military and what it was like going into Vietnam. And then this dude just blows his head off in the barracks. You know, like, that's not something I imagine happened very often. So after that, like, I'm wondering, like, is this just sensationalism now? Like, am I not going to get that realistic portrayal that I was kind of hoping for?
Well, here's the one thing about the realism that I had a problem with. And I only know this because if you look closely enough, and I've been to Southeast Asia, I've been to Cambodia, I was in Vietnam for a day for a trap. He filmed this in London.
Correct.
But if you, and it, look, here's the thing. We talk about authenticity. I'm talking about more about the atmosphere now, Alan, the literal air, you know, the environment. But if you look closely enough, as good as Kubrick is, the single palm tree every 20 yards didn't do it for me.
Yeah. That's not going to sell it.
And I'm not, I mean, I don't have experience in Vietnam like these guys, but I've been to Southeast Asia. And once you get outside the city, it's just green jungle everywhere. So it didn't, the believability of the atmosphere to me was, it was a good attempt. And if you're not really paying attention, like, I was probably paying too much attention to the environment, but as good as he did, the only time that it worked is when they were in close and the buildings were burning and the smoke was coming up. But if you were looking at like a large area, like I'm seeing way more trees than that. And I just didn't get the authenticity of it. I look at like other war films that you think about. I mean, fucking Coppola went to Vietnam or to, I can't remember where he went.
He went to the Philippines.
The Philippines, thank you. To film Apocalypse Now. So.
And Oliver Stone went to the Philippines to film Platoon.
Right.
And to film Born on the 4th of July.
So either it's two things. It's either he's exceptional at tricking it, or he was just lazy and didn't want to travel to another country.
Well, I do know this. I also read this on Kubrick, was that after, I think it was Spartacus, Kubrick moved to London and swore that he would never film another movie in the United States. He would only film it in England.
No, that is true. That's historically and I know, accurate. That I know.
And I'm no expert, but from everything that I've read or seen about the Battle of Wei, which is portrayed in the second part of Full Metal Jacket, it was a very urban battle.
Right.
So he was able to get away with it filmed in England because it was a very urban place. All he had to do was find a place and tear it down, essentially.
Right. Create a demolitioned, urbanized environment.
Correct.
Yeah. And he does well there. And that's not to get that cinematography at the end is beautiful.
Amazing. I agree. To piggyback on what both of you said, the thing in the bathroom, the suicide, I think was a great scene, not only to show how crazy Private Pyle became, but once that death happens in a way, and this, I'm only hypothesizing here. There's no proof. I'm just taking a guess. I'm hypothesizing that suicide was also perfect because it desensitizes Private Joker to the death that he's going to see in Vietnam.
That, you know what? That's a good point. Because
I'm just saying.
That's a really good point because I was kind of wondering why, to me, it's the strongest point, the strongest part of the whole film is the first half. I'm kind of wondering why they even included it though, because it really has no bearing on what happens to Joker or Cowboy or anybody. Like they don't discuss it. I don't see them affect them, but I think that's a really good point. I'm glad you brought it up.
Again, I'm hypothesizing, I think that suicide scene was perfect because not only does it show how crazy Private Pyle got, but also psychologically desensitizes Private Joker to what he's going to see. Because remember, he's not trained to go to combat. He's a photographer for Stars and Stripes. So in a way, he goes to battle and he's already desensitized to seeing fucking brains blown out, you know? But yeah,
that's what I was trying to say. I didn't say it as elegantly as you, James, but that's the precursor to things they'll see later on. And it's and like you said, it's even more than what they're going to experience because it's so up close and personal in a way.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with you 100%. And then they get to Vietnam and Joker, like you mentioned, James is basically a field reporter or field journalist for Stars and Stripes, which I guess is a in-house military.
Yeah. It's a military newspaper. Now it's online as well, obviously, because of technology, but yeah, it was a military newspaper.
Still exists. Does it still exist?
That is correct. Okay. Yeah. I follow it on Facebook. So absolutely. Yeah. It's still real.
To see how they kind of have the spin machine going, you know, like how we're going to kind of spin some of the stuff where it's not search and destroy anymore. I can't remember what they renamed it.
It's sweep and clear.
Sweep and clear. Sweep and clear.
Yeah.
It was, to me, that was very interesting to kind of, and who knows how realistic that is, but to actually get like an inside look into kind of the thought process behind it was pretty cool.
I mean, I've seen a documentary where they talked about how the government and the military, not necessarily the military, but the government tried to spin the amounts of deaths that we had versus the Vietnamese. So the scene in theory could be plausible, realistic, whatever you want to call it. So again, I wasn't there obviously, but I think it could be real.
You don't have to say that. We're hypothesizing everything on this fucking podcast.
Yeah.
All I do on this show is talk out of my ass. I have
never enough.
I had both Alan and I, all we've done for the last year is talk out our ass about movies and pretend, although Alan's had some good theories and I've enjoyed them. I've had one good theory. I think Alan's had about three or four.
But it's like I said, I got to know, or at least sound like I know what I'm talking about, because my dad's going to listen to this too.
Well, I think you're sounding great so far. And by the way, my one theory, and I remember that Alan's had a good handful, I think, of good theories. He had one on Hereditary, and we've discussed a couple others. I've only had one, Alan, and you know what that I think is good, and maybe it sucks ass, I don't know. The Shining. I had a good, if you go back and listen to that, I had a decent hypothesis analysis of what that movie means.
I'm going to go back and re-listen because I don't remember.
That's okay. I don't expect you to.
That was like a podcast. So
that was a 3-hour podcast. Yeah. We get to Vietnam. Joker is part of Stars and Stripes, a field journalist. And what did we feel about kind of the, and it's hard to, and this is where we can put a little preface to our assessment, so to speak, is that, of course, I don't know anything about Vietnam other than what you read and hear about and see in the movies, right? Like,
yeah.
Or like for me growing up, because that was my dad's age, like my dad was drafted and like all his buddies were drafted. And so like all my friends growing up in our neighborhood, either their dads served in Vietnam or, you know what I mean? Like we're of that age group. So those are the only secondhand tells that I have of it, but I'm curious to kind of get your guys' thoughts on the experience and following Joker through. Here's where I thought Kubrick got a little convoluted on his approach to kind of portraying the Vietnam experience, because I kind of thought we were going to follow Joker singularly all the way through. Now he's always there and he always pops up, but there's a lot of like deviant sections that deviate from Joker and try to go into other areas, little other platoons or other soldiers or other things, and he's trying to sprinkle in these other things. And so the authenticity of it got lost to me just a little bit, because I didn't have anywhere to focus my interest in terms of like the actual experience. And to sum it up, here's, and then I'll open it up to you guys, but what I'm thinking is like I have neighborhood friends growing up whose dad served. And one thing about it, and maybe this is what Kubrick's trying to do, I don't know, is that we were always curious. I had two friends in particular whose dad served in Vietnam and served a couple tours. Like they were legitimately on the fighting lines doing whatever they did. They never talked about it, ever. I was always curious because Vietnam's got a stigma to it and a history culturally as Americans. And so I was curious. I always wanted to hear stories, and their mouths were zipped. They were shut. And so maybe that's what Kubrick's trying to do, is to be a little more widespread on his approach to not jump. Cause I don't think it's about Joker all the way. I don't know. What do you guys think?
How about you, Jane?
I'll let Alan go first.
I don't think this movie's about Joker at all. Like okay. I think he's kind of the through line. It almost felt like I think this is where I kind of struggle with the second half of this, because it just kind of felt like little vignettes.
Exactly. That's the word I was looking for. Yeah.
And that's like, it's fine, but man, that first half was so good and it was so engaging. And to kind of, and then you think like, we're finally going to get to the war. Like, holy shit, man. And then it's just kind of like this happens and then they go here and then this is happening. And I just didn't feel like there's a whole lot of continuity, I guess. And so I think that's kind of, I think the second half of this film just, I don't want to say fell apart. I'm not going to go that far, but it's not nearly as strong for sure.
Yeah. The shotgun approach. Do you know what I mean? It's like the first part of the film, singular focus. We're following a couple characters as pretty intently. And then all of a sudden it kind of widens out and I lose a little bit. Joker's still there, but there's a little more spread, you know? What do you think, James?
All right. So first thing, I know the movie is based on two books, one called The Short Timers and one called Dispatches. And I think one of the writers of one of the books co-wrote the script, if I'm not mistaken. So that being said, I never read the books, but I know my father did. And my father said that both the books, when it gets to the part of Vietnam, is very episodic and like vignettes. Like, it's not one story about one person. They're all different stories. And some people are in each of them. Almost kind of like Pulp Fiction, if that makes sense.
And they cross paths periodically. Exactly. And yes.
Exactly. So that is why, in my opinion, the second half of the movie is like that. Because I'm guessing they obviously couldn't do all of that in the movie, so they kind of put it all together. That's my guess.
Have you guys seen Deer Hunter?
Absolutely.
I have not.
So I feel like, and correct me if I'm wrong, James, because you're probably more of an expert on Deer Hunter. I've only seen it a couple times.
Fair enough.
And it's been a while. It's been a while. So, but in Deer Hunter, there is a little more of a singular focus on a couple, like there's three friends, right? And you kind of follow their journey, no? Like, it's just those guys.
Yeah, I think it's three. I'm trying to think. It's Christopher Walken and Robert De Niro and the third guy.
I don't remember. Yeah. But my point being is, like, I kind of, what I liked about that was that I just attached to them and I kind of rode that journey all the way through. Yeah. Whereas here, that widespread kind of threw me off and got a little convoluted and I wasn't really sure who to follow. And I didn't look, I'm crazy that I'm saying this because I still like the movie and I love Kubrick, but I didn't really care for Joker so much that I cared about him, that how it ended. It wasn't so, I was so enthralled that I got to know how Joker's going to end this thing or how Joker's going to turn out. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. But getting back, because I was going to say something else. Like I said, the second half of the movie could be because the books were very episodic and were like vignettes, like you guys said. So they combined everything. So that could be. But the other thing is, you made the comment about guys who've been in Vietnam and they don't talk any about it. Well, that I know for a fact, because I know a lot of people, in fact, most people I know who've been to Iraq or Afghanistan, all they ever say is, yeah, I deployed to Iraq or Afghanistan. Or they say who they were with, like what unit. And that's it. They don't talk about anything, especially if they've seen combat. So that could be another reason, because they know from the veterans' experience that a lot of these guys don't talk about it.
So. Right, and they're kind of leaving that vague openness to stay more authentic in some way or
exactly.
another.
Exactly. Yeah, because PTSD, you know, a lot of guys who've been over there to see combat, they don't like talking about it because the people they talk about it have never been in those situations, or a lot of them haven't. So
yeah, no relatability
at all. I think that had something to do with it as well. So
no, I think that's a really good point. And I think I have. You know, close family and other people who have served and seen combat, and you're right, they don't talk about it. So, no. And even to me, who's a close friend or family member, they're not going to discuss it. Cause I, like we've discussed already three times in this podcast, I have jack shit knowledge about the military. So, it makes sense. It makes sense. And maybe I think that's a good way to approach it, but it still got me a little bit lost in the characters and like who I was supposed to follow. However, it was still, the vignettes were done so well that I was engaged to continue watching. Right.
One other thing to piggyback on it. You guys aren't the only ones. Most everyone I know who've seen Full Metal Jacket, almost all of them say the first half's great. The second half, it's just okay. Yeah. So you guys aren't the only one. So,
I mean, there's funny experiences in the vignettes. Like if you had to choose one, I'll just open it up for this question so we can kind of move to the end of the movie, but
fair enough.
But pick a scene in there in the second half that stood out or that you enjoyed, that you liked, not the ending, but just in between the time they get to Vietnam and to the ending, pick a scene that stood out or you liked. Go ahead, Alan, with yours up first.
I mean, I don't know if I'd say I liked it. It was pretty disturbing. It's when you're just shooting the people out of the helicopter, you know, like to me, that's, to even get to a place where, I think it was shocking, to Joker, and I can't remember who the photographer, I can't remember what his name was. He was obviously disturbed by it because he's about to throw
Raptor Man.
Yeah, that's right.
Raptor Man.
To get to a point where that, you know, you understand it's messed up, but it's not affecting you that much, to me, that's kind of the point of the movie, to me, is that James, it makes even more sense thinking back now to what you said about how Joker was just desensitized after what happened to Pyle. Like,
yeah, because he's sitting there not even really having a reaction to it. He's just asking a question.
Yeah, he's asking a question, and a legitimate question, like, how can you do that? But he's not like, he's not offended. He's not disgusted. He's not upset by it. You know, he's just like, how can you do that? It doesn't, you know, it's almost like he's just trying to understand. But to me, that kind of summed up the entire movie. That's kind of the point of the movie, right?
I'm assuming, again, I'm no expert, but
that's what I got.
I have a couple of scenes. One is the same scene you mentioned, Alan, the door gunner. I'm going to be honest, and a lot of veteran friends I have are the same way. I can't stop laughing through that helicopter scene. That door gunner was amazing. He's hilarious.
His personality is hilarious. Like
his personality is hilarious. Thank you.
It's great.
But the other scene that I think nails it home in the movie, and it's not a humorous scene, it's when Joker gets yelled at by the colonel, and the colonel goes, "Why do you have a born to kill statement on your helmet but a peace symbol on your shirt?" And Joker goes, "Well, it's because of the duality of man." And I think that, again, just me talking out loud, spitballing ideas, I think that was the whole point of the movie, was the duality of man.
I think you're right.
You can have some guy who's normal and fine. He sees some dude blow his brains out. And then after that, he's like completely desensitized to war and death and whatnot, you know?
He becomes
one of these guys who's a killer, but, you know, at the same time, he wants peace, you know?
Yeah, that's a great scene. And he's delivering that line of the duality of man behind 20 dead bodies.
Exactly, yeah. And if I remember correctly, he makes a comment about how the newspaper was going to inflate or change the number of dead bodies for the news.
Yes.
So it goes back to the earlier scene. But again, I just spitballing an idea. I think that whole line with the colonel and the duality of man nails what the whole movie is about. At least that's my opinion.
You know what? I think you're right. I think you're absolutely right. I think that's it. I think you just figured out Kubrick.
I agree. That scene stands out. But what about Me Love You Long Time?
Oh, well, that's I have no experience with prostitutes. So
James, I do got to ask you this. Would you even bother trying to talk them down in price, or would you just be like, I'm on, let's do it?
Well, first of all, you're talking to a guy who takes the stems out of cherries and grapes so they weigh less and cost less at the supermarket.
Okay, so how far down are you trying to talk them?
You know, like a lot. I would have been fine with five. So
all right.
You know, and I would have used a similar line about my parents won't allow me to spend more than $10. So, yeah, just saying. But anyway.
It made me laugh. I mean, it's a sad commentary on everything, but it was still still comedic.
Yes, I agree.
And so we kind of follow Joker throughout. We kind of, as we get toward, oh, go ahead, Alan.
That your favorite scene? Is that the vignette that you like the most?
The Me Love You Long Time? I did laugh my ass off again. I thought it was funny.
Funny.
I actually, it's funny because I kind of like the scene because I like the scenes that give me some form of explanation. And I think James nailed it. I did like that scene because I was wondering that before when I saw it. I didn't get it, to be honest. I'm too stupid. So I was like, I saw the peace sign and then you see Born to Kill. But when he explained it out, when he talks about the duality, man, I liked that scene a lot because then I could kind of understand some of the meaning behind it going forward.
I feel like we needed that. We needed, you know, a little concrete exposition there.
It's also, look, there's visual representations of it too. That I'm thinking about it because the scene you were talking about with the door gunner, he's the opposite. He's the born to kill side. And the photographer that's with the Rafterman, that's with Joker, he's kind of the peace side, because he's not feeling it. He hates it. Do you know what I mean? So yeah. Like even visual representation between characters, that message comes across.
Just like when Rafterman appears sick when he sees all the dead bodies,
yep.
But Joker's just looking at it. By the way, side note, I just want to point this out. I know you're a big Star Wars fan, Gabe. The colonel that yells at Joker was one of the rebel commanders in Empire Strikes Back.
Oh,
you're
really?
Welcome. You're welcome. Just want to throw that out there.
Now I got to go double check that, verify that that fact is on point.
Okay.
I believe you, though. I believe you.
Yeah.
So we follow Joker, and then they get to kind of this lat. Joker meets up with, is it Cowboy, right? He meets up with Cowboy, correct. Who he went to boot camp with. Cowboy's correct. Running a small infantry or a small platoon, a small number of guys. And we get to this end scene, and or towards the end scene, I should say. This was kind of interesting to me, the way this played out. And they basically... they run into a town with a sniper, right? And the sniper's taking people out. He's taking a couple of the platoon members out. It ran a little slow for me.
Oh, really? I'm just the opposite. I like this part.
I loved the first. I mean, I don't know. Maybe it was just me wanting to see. I was upset is what I mean. And the reason I was upset is because I was so mad that this whole platoon couldn't navigate around one person. And then when it's revealed who that person is, it's not a, the age of that person was saddening. And I was so mad that this little girl who's got to be like 13 or 12 was taking people out. And this whole platoon, at least, was it two of them, three of them, got destroyed, three. And what do they say? They used a term in the actual dialogue.
Wasted.
Wasted. They got wasted by this young Vietnamese sniper.
Yeah.
I know this sounds like very patriotic American, but I was like, come on, you guys got to figure this shit out.
Well, that's kind of that kind of sums up the Vietnam War, right? The superpower America, go capitalism, can't beat these communist, Viet Cong. It kind of sums up the entire war. It's kind of...
No, you're absolutely right. There's a great analogy going on there. Yeah, for sure.
The part of this whole sequence that... It didn't hit me right. Was the every single time one of these guys got shot, the brutal slow motion and the brutal screaming that is just, I mean, he just hammers you over the head with it. He really loves that slow motion. Shot in the foot. Let's cut back to the platoon. Shot in the gut. Let's cut back to the platoon. Like, it just went on and on.
And can we say, I mean, 8-Ball can take a shot, because he took like, I don't know how big those rounds are. Those were big rounds. He was still alive like 5 minutes in, taking shots to the leg and other areas. I'm pretty sure he would have been dead like 4 minutes earlier. I'm just saying. James, it's a lot of shots to take.
Correct.
That's all I'm saying.
Like a video game or something, man.
What'd you think about that scene leading up to the end there, where they're getting basically sabotaged by a single soldier on the Viet Cong side?
For Alan or me?
For you, James.
Oh, I mean, I enjoyed it. Yeah. I mean, you guys have kind of hit all everything I was going to say, especially the whole analogy about the Vietnam War, little young kids that are like 17 years old, they're kicking her ass, yeah, I don't, you guys kind of covered everything.
And here's the other thing. So 8-Ball goes out, 8-Ball gets taken out. And then is it Mother? What's his name?
Well, it's Doc J and 8-Ball. They get wasted. And then Mother goes out there with the 60 cal.
That's right. Mother goes out. And this is, once again, you see the visual representation, because Cowboy wants nothing to do with it. He's going to hold back. He doesn't want to go into the fire, right? And Mother's like, I'm going all in. So you have kind of two individual type, the duality of the guy that doesn't want to do it and the guy that's going to go full throttle. Mother goes running in, starts to figure it out. Cowboy reluctantly gets pulled in by Mother to say, hey, he's calling him in because he's telling him there's just one sniper. You got to come up to this point where it's safe. And then Cowboy takes a group of guys, including Joker and himself, up to that point and gets taken out. And that's it. That was a tough one to watch. That scene, actually, that when he gets to Cowboy, that was a tough one for me. I felt it. Like it felt real. It felt authentic when he goes out.
And did you notice that during Cowboy's death scene, there's a structure in the back that looks like the black monolith from 2001 Space Odyssey?
No, but now I'm like really intrigued.
And supposedly Kubrick was asked about that, and he just chuckled and he goes, oh, it must have been a coincidence. I didn't mean to do that, which I think is bullshit. And knowing what I know about Kubrick, he fucking put it there on purpose.
So is this when Cowboy's dying?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So the shot of like Joker holding underneath him and it's behind him, there's a monolith.
It's a structure that looks very much like the monolith from 2001.
Now I got to go back and watch that section.
Just saying.
Kubrick was very meticulous with everything.
There's no way he did that by accident.
Right.
He fucking wanted and planned to put it there to fuck with people.
Of course.
So
he's lying in his grave right now laughing his ass off because he's like,
exactly.
These three knuckleheads are talking about monoliths in Full Metal Jacket. What a bunch of dumbasses.
He was doing it, and I'm sure he was thinking, I'm fucking Stanley Kubrick. I can do whatever the fuck I want. I'm going to put it in there.
And he can, because by the way, a side note, James, you were saying he didn't after Spartacus. That's all true, by the way. After Spartacus, it left a bad taste in his mouth. And he was like, I'm not going back to film. And also, he's going to do everything his way with full creative control. So because of that, like you said, he didn't do things unintentionally. He had full creative control and full intention.
And I've had to show, like literally go to websites and show people that I knew in the military who did not believe, like, for example, they thought The Shining was filmed in Colorado. And I'm like, you're fake news. It's filmed in fucking England. And same thing with Full Metal Jacket. I tell people it's filmed in London. And they're like, no, it had to be filmed at Paris Island in Vietnam or the Philippines. I'm like, no, you're fake news. I've had to show people this because nobody believes me.
Well, it's like Eyes Wide Shut. It's supposed to be New York. It's not New York.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And by the way, guys, just because I say fake news doesn't mean I endorse Donald Trump. I just like saying fake news. Just saying. Okay.
It didn't cross my mind, but now that you brought it up,
no.
Let's get into politics.
I like the term. I like calling people fake news. Just saying.
We'll move on. We'll get to the last little bit here. Cowboy dies. They find their way. They smoke it out. They get up to the building where this sniper was. Joker, Mother, the photographer, Rafterman, all these guys are seeking out this sniper that took their platoon out, or at least the members of their platoon. And it's revealed Joker. This was an interesting scene, the ending to me, because this is where I was curious about authenticity. Okay. He takes his rifle. He looks forward. He sees the sniper in front of him and he goes to shoot and his rifle clicks. It's empty. What the fuck is that about? That's not real. No soldier's going to have an empty round in there. What's going on?
I can't speak on that specific scenario, like you just said in the movie. I can't speak on that. However, I will say this. I've been in an experience or two where I've seen guys who are all gung-ho and, you know, saying they were ready to, you know, kill the bad guys like John Wayne and give this whole American speech. And then when the shit hits the fan, they fall apart like the Patriots playing the Giants in the Super Bowl. Just saying. So,
or James, for you, I'm going to throw this out there, like the Falcons playing the Patriots
in the Super Bowl. Correct. Yes. But it's like I said, I can't speak on that specific scene where it goes click, but I do know of experiences.
I get what you're saying. I get that he fumbles and that I just didn't like the, I would have almost rather liked him to just not be able to do it because he can't do it. I didn't like that his gun was empty. The rifle had no rounds.
Yeah, I actually didn't mind the scene because it was more, to me, it would be more original than a guy who couldn't do it, who couldn't pull the trigger, I mean.
Yeah.
That's just me.
Considering what he does later, you know, like in a few minutes.
Correct. He does make up for it in a way.
So basically, he fumbles the gun. The empty rounds don't fire, so he fumbles his gun. He kind of has an internal moment, and then his photographer friend Rafterman, right? It's Rafterman.
Rafterman.
He take this. By the way, this sniper turns around when she. This is a. I'm saying like 13 years old. Like this is a young girl. Turns around and just starts firing with a vengeance. Upon Joker, like no, it's like the wrath is coming down on him. She has no reservation about just letting it fly.
Yeah,
and then fortunately, Rafterman in this case, I don't even say fortunately because it's still sad either way. But Rafterman comes in and takes out the sniper. Rafterman's jacked up about taking this. About taking this girl out.
I think, I mean, because it just seems like he wanted combat. That's all he wanted. He wanted to get the, and now he's there and he's done something quote unquote heroic, depending on how you look at it. And he's jacked up, but it's also kind of like, dude, read the room. That was a child, you know, like it's, I understand you had to do it, but you should be jacked up because it is a kid.
This is once again where Kubrick plays. And I'll use that word, that phrase again, but there is a duality there because part of you is excited that Joker was saved because you want to see him saved. Part of you is devastated that a 13-year-old kid, I'm just making the age up, but she's young as hell.
Yeah.
13-year-old kid is dead and in a position that they have to be what they're doing what they're doing. Do you know what I mean? And you play those dual forces again really well. She doesn't die entirely. She's still kind of fumbling on the ground. She starts rolling off a prayer and doing her thing. And then this is where Joker has to meet his decision. Right. And this is where it's interesting again, because the reality is the girl's going to die. Mother says it, he says the line, she's dead meat.
Yeah.
And so she's going to die either way. So Joker's decision to shoot her with his hand, with his pistol, and kind of it to me, it's like shooting Old Yeller. That's the worst thing I know, but you know what I mean? Like,
I know what you're saying. Yeah.
You have a suffering individual who's in no way going to live. And so,
and it's a no win.
Is he doing her a favor or is he crossed the line? I don't know. This is where there's other decisions, because you're talking about human life, that it gets real sensitive. And we know this is a movie, so we can talk about it in Old Yeller terms, but because it's
you never know. Even when he does mercy kill, I guess you could say, the girl, you never really know if he's still Joker or if he's crossed over. That being said, I did read that supposedly there was going to be a scene, I don't know if they ever shot it, but supposedly there was going to be a scene where Mother takes the machete that he carries the whole movie and chops her head off. and then holds her head up like a fucking trophy in Clash of the Titans. You know, when he has Medusa's head.
Yeah.
So
I'm glad.
By the way, side note, slightly to go back to the duality of man, there was a filmed scene that I read that they deleted where it shows U.S. soldiers playing soccer, and the camera zooms in like Kubrick usually does, and you find out the soccer ball is a severed human head.
See, I'm glad they didn't do that, because I love gore, you know, I love gore. It's great, but I don't think we needed those type of over the top moments to sell it. You know, like, I think he already sold it.
I completely agree. I mean, I would still like to see the deleted scene though.
Yeah.
But I agree. They had already established a duality. They wouldn't need that scene. I agree. So.
And that leaves us with the end credits, which
I love this little scene, this little sequence to close out the film, where the city is burning. They have absolutely obliterated this town, and they are singing the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse as they march back. Like, to me, it's just like, here's your freedom. Here's the freedom we brought to you. You know, to me, it's just, I just love, it was such a beautiful shot. And it really, I mean, the fact that they're singing a Mickey Mouse song, it's so great. It was a great choice.
Well, I also think that the end scene would be the final nail in the coffin for the whole point of duality of man. There they are. They just killed some girl who was killing them. And they're walking through a city where I'm sure they're going to have to deal with more combat. And they're singing a fucking kid's song. So to me, like I said, though, again, just my idea and opinion, I think the whole movie is about duality of man.
Yeah, and not just a kid's song, a capitalist Disney kid's song. That's
very correct.
Very American. Absolutely. Child's, right.
But so. it rolls credits with the Rolling Stones.
Correct, called Paint It Black.
Paint It Black.
I'm not a huge Rolling Stones fan, but I love that song. I actually let the credits roll just so I could listen to the song.
It's a great song. I like that song a lot too. And there you have it. We've kind of walked through this Kubrick film titled Full Metal Jacket. I have a couple of run-throughs I want to do with you guys. Then I want to get your guys' rating. James, if you remember, the rating system for us is 1 out of 10, right?
Okay.
And then you choose a prop or a representation, a symbol. So like rifles or whatever, 7 rifles or whatever it might be. So I'll let you think about that for a second while I go through some of these.
Okay.
So this is Alan's favorite part of the podcast that we've introduced over the last little while.
I love this, man. Some of the reviews are amazing.
Alan, I don't know how this is going to roll over with this type of movie.
I know. I was wondering that, because we're not – it's not real controversial on whether it's good or not. So you're not, I don't think you're going to get people. I don't know.
We have 149 reviews on Google. I like to read a few sentences from each review, James, and just see what people are saying about this film. So
go for it.
We have one here, and just the first couple sentences, of course, is what we would expect. It was amazing, in all caps, by the way.
In all caps. They're always in all caps.
It's always all caps.
It's good or bad, it's always in all caps.
And here's a controversial statement. This is why I don't like these kind of reviews, because I don't know that I can believe it to what he's saying. Okay. So he says it was amazing. It teaches me a lot about what they were like in war. Seems a little naive to me. I'm not saying there's not authentic themes but I just mean that it teaches. I don't know about that.
The real question is, did it scare that person before? That was one of the best reviews ever. It said, I think the review was just, it scared me to core.
No, but it does say this, Alan. It says, it was a great plot twist when the fat guy was getting punished in a really terrible way and then killed their captain. First off, who's the fat guy? And there is no captain.
So, yeah.
Let's get our facts straight here, Till Wolf.
So, once again, someone is fake news. Just saying.
Yeah, Till Wolf's review is encapsulates why I love this segment so much. Yes. It's just
listening
so
to people articulate their responses. Okay, here's one that kind of goes along with what we were saying, and in just a few sentences here. First half is entertaining, and second half is dark. That's a fair assessment. Mm-hmm. Although, okay, no, that's fair. That's fair. Yeah. And like James, I'm just pulling these. I haven't researched these. I'm on the fly here.
You're good. No worries.
Okay, here's one from Dustin V. Thanks a lot, Dustin V. I'm excluding your last name so I don't throw you under the bus. It is a 5-star review, though. He says, wow, period. I think I watched this for the first time in my early 30s. It was all right, but I didn't get all of the obsession with the other guys I knew had for it. These guys cannot write. Now I am watching it again at 41, and I have to say my mind is much more open and I am catching so much that just flew over me last time around. Okay, Dustin V, you're fair. Now I'm trying to find one with some here's a 4-star. The film screams of testosterone hormones. I think I grew a pair of balls of my own. That's Alyssa C. Alyssa C. grew a pair of balls for us. Thanks, Alyssa.
You know, I'm not sure if I can agree with that review, but it's quite funny.
That was good writing. No?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. I'm scrolling through. There's 149, but I wanted to find one. Okay. Janine G. Very much a Stanley Kubrick film. I watched Black Hawk Down yesterday. Full Metal Jacket is meant to spend a lot of time on boot camp and the unknown of the fight. I don't know what that means, Jenny G. Please come again. I really want to find a negative one. So far, all these are...
The best are the ones where it has a lot of reviews and then someone gets so pissed off, or a lot of good reviews, and someone gets so angry and livid that everyone loves the movie because then they just can't hold back.
Right. Here's one too, Alan. Overall, it's a great movie, but there are its flaws and weaknesses. I'm reading these verbatim. There are its flaws and weaknesses. I suggest watching videos going over the actual on YouTube to get a better understanding of why certain parts are included in the movie and how it all connects. First off, go back to grammar school. Second off, articulate your syntax. Those were horrible structures of sentences. And you're out of here. Go YouTube to figure out how Vietnam works. Okay, thank you.
You say that you has there are its flaws and weaknesses?
Yeah.
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 I think that.
Joshua W., 1-star. Finally, here it is. This is what I was looking for. First time I've read it. Full Metal Jacket is possibly the most pointless Vietnam War ever produced. A war movie. I'm sorry. I actually flubbed up there. Sorry, Joshua. Let me start over. Full Metal Jacket.
You get an articulate one and Gabe screws it up.
Flub it up. Full Metal Jacket is possibly the most pointless Vietnam War movie ever produced. Terrible meandering storyline and dialogue intermixed with even worse acting from Modine makes this one of the easiest no's for me.
Interesting.
Joshua W. 6 months ago coming in with thunder.
I mean, I get the points. I think he's just overstating his criticism. I don't think Mathew Modine was bad. I just don't think he was good.
Yeah, he was neutral.
Yeah, he's very neutral.
You cruise neutral the whole movie.
Which is okay. Interesting in a war movie.
True. Okay, last one. Here it is. Terry D., 1 year ago, 1-star. The Mickey Mouse song at the end seems like Kubrick was insulting the Marines. My dad and my brother both fought in this war at the same time. I was offended.
Damn.
Can I say that first off, Terry D, get the fuck out of here. And then second off, one person found that useful.
Yeah. And you know what? It was probably Terry D.
Terry D finding it her own review useful.
Yeah.
I mean, what about you, James? You were in the military. Did you find this offensive?
Negative.
Yeah, I can't. I don't know. I don't see how this is like an anti-Marine or military movie. I don't see it.
Yeah.
I don't see that one either. But we found two negative reviews, so that was pretty good. All right, I'm going to read off Rotten Tomatoes reviews and IMDb, and then I'm going to ask James for yours and Alan for yours. So we have Rotten Tomatoes coming in at 92% from the critics and 94% from the audience. Critics ratings, 83 reviews, and users on the audience, 325,000. So there's a lot there. Both high, or I guess low to mid 90s. So pretty high. And that's always kind of, we always talk about this. That's kind of interesting because usually there's a disparity between the critics and the audiences, but they're right on the same number. And then you have IMDb. IMDb comes at, this is pretty high, out of 600,000 plus reviews. It's at an 8.3 out of 10.
On IMDb, that's really good.
Really high. So a couple pieces of trivia. I just have a couple. James, if you have a couple extras, we'll throw it in there. I'm just reading a couple here that I found, nothing extravagant. Which for me as an editor, I thought was cool, nerd filmmaker. This was Stanley Kubrick's first film edited by computer rather than spliced film. So I thought that was cool because I'm a nerd. And then I thought this was cool because I found it interesting that Arlie Ermey would say this, but he felt that Vincent D'Onofrio's performance was the best in the film. That's coming from Arlie Ermey, who I actually thought was the best in the film. So
yeah, I think Arlie Ermey definitely by far best performance, but D'Onofrio, he was really good too.
And then my last trivia, and then I'll throw it to James for any trivia. And if not, that's fine. And then your score, James, out of 10. During filming, a family of rabbits were accidentally killed. Stanley Kubrick, an animal lover, was so upset that he canceled the rest of the day's work.
How much money did that cost?
but isn't there the irony there of making a film about homicide, murder, war, and rabbits dying? We're done. I don't know.
Or you could say it's about duality of filmmaking. Just saying.
Boom.
Look at that.
Yep. Truth bombs.
With that, lead into your rating and or some trivia if you have it, or your rating. Your summation of the movie, James.
Okay. All right. Well, first of all, I do one other piece of trivia I know that I was going to say was I was watching the making of Full Metal Jacket, and they were talking about a scene that they were filming in the city because they filmed this combat in the city first and then basic training last. Well, anyway, they were filming the part in the city, and you know how Kubrick was. They were up to like 45 or 50 takes, and one of the actors is like, oh, my God. We're up to like 50 takes. What else does Stanley Kubrick want? And Kubrick just looked at him and said, how about better acting?
So, I love that.
That being said, I did want to go off on a slight tangent, and I apologize, but I'll make it quick. Speaking of reviews, there's this guy I know who's in the military with me. I'm not going to name his name, Jim Horan. Sorry. he was telling me once that, Born on the 4th of July was garbage, but Hudson Hawk is a great movie. Just saying, because we're talking about reviews.
That's the that's a Bruce Willis movie, right?
Correct. That's often cited as one of the worst movies ever made.
He was comparing Born on 4th of July to Hudson Hawk and saying Hudson Hawk was better.
Well, we were talking about movies in general, and he's like, yeah, Hudson Hawk, that's way better than some supposed classics like As Good As It Gets or Born on the 4th of July. They won Oscars, but they're garbage. Hudson Hawk is way better. So I just want to talk about reviews slightly.
Okay, so tell me, I love, that's hilarious to me because Born on 4th of July is a great movie. Tell me your review of this film. And better than Hudson Hawk? Let's start there.
Well, first of all, Hudson Hawk, that my opinion of that movie is somewhere between a cockroach and the white stuff that forms on the corner of my mouth when I'm really thirsty. Okay. So that should tell you what I feel about that movie.
Full Metal Jacket, I'd give at least a 7 out of 10 or 8 out of 10. It's not my favorite war movie, but it's definitely very good. So
8 out of 10, what?
What? It, what do you, what?
Symbols. Can you come up?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Give me something.
Eight rifles out of 10. There you go.
What, so. What, and then as a side note, and then we'll jump into Alan's, tell me your do you have a favorite war movie?
Yeah, actually, and you're not going to believe it because only like the last 30 minutes is war, Zero Dark 30, believe it or not.
Nice. Yeah. That's a good movie.
Yeah, very good. So I would say that and probably Platoon are my top two.
Did Catherine Bigelow direct Zero Dark 30?
She did.
And she also directed Alan's favorite movie called The Loveless.
I've never even heard of The Loveless.
It is so beyond garbage.
It stars William Dafoe, and Alan absolutely loved it when I picked it for him to review.
What do you think about Catherine Bigelow and Willem Dafoe? I mean, you would think they're both very young in their careers at this point, but you would think it'd be good, right? It's not. It's awful. Don't even bother.
I've never even heard of it.
It's her first movie as a director. It's horrible. But Zero Dark 30 is a great film. I agree. I like that a lot. James, nice review. I liked your that extra bit of trivia. Let's jump into Alan and see where his summary and review is on his rating. Where are you at, Alan?
I forgot to say one thing I did like. I liked when we were discussing some of the vignettes. I liked when they were interviewing the soldiers too. And I just wanted to say that because it actually ties into my score. Was it Cowboy who said there are no horses in Vietnam?
That is correct.
That was a great line. He's like, there's not even a single horse in the country of Vietnam. Like, that was pretty funny to me.
And that's how he related it to being a fucked up country, because there's no horses.
Yeah, I thought it was great. But anyway, this film is it's the duality, man. I like, James, that you brought that up, because everything's starting to fit together now. I love it when you get that little piece that you overlooked or didn't think about, and it just everything clicks. And it's kind of doing that now for me. It's two halves are very different. And the first half, I think, is fantastic. I think that's the story. That's what we needed. End it there. And honestly, I might give this like an 8.5 or a 9, which is very, very hard for me to do. But it goes on, and it just kind of floats after that. Like, it's okay. It's not bad. Some beautiful shots, some great sequences, obviously done very well by a master filmmaker, and the craft is great, but the story's just not there, and I'm not engaged. I don't really care that much. So that knocks it down quite a bit. I'm going to go 7.1 horses in Vietnam.
7.1. Okay. Nice. So I'm going with James with an 8 and Alan with a 7.1. So for me, as we enter this phase of starting to break down some of Kubrick's films, this one to me, I think it's a great movie. I really do. I was in some way or another, even with some of the elements of confusion of, am I supposed to follow this character or this character as we get into it? Overall, I was enthralled. I was engaged. I was interested. A big thing for me is like anybody, are you losing interest and do you stop caring? And even though I was a little confused on should I follow Joker or this little vignette or this thing, I still was engaged. Like, it kept me interested. I think, like everything, like you mentioned, Alan, like when you start talking about it, new things start coming into your mind. So now I have to go back and rewatch certain things with that new pair of eyes. And James, one thing I always do on a film review, and Alan knows this, is like, what's the rewatchability factor? Can I rewatch this?
Absolutely.
Over and over. Right. But every time I watch a movie, like, and then also if I can, where does it fit on the scale of rewatchability? Like, is this a yearly watch? Is it a biannual watch? Is it every 2 years, every 10 years? What is it?
And I would say for me, I watch it every couple of months, like every other month or so.
You're a frequent watcher. So
absolutely. Just because I think it's funny. So, you know, it's more.
Yeah, you could watch, comedy, you could watch the first 20 minutes of this film, 30 minutes of this film, and just walk away happy and absolutely elated and in a good mood, I think.
Well, I tell people, I don't like a lot of comedies that come out, you know, for example, and I'm mentioning this for a buddy of mine. For example, I didn't like comedies like Norbit or Little Nicky, right, that are supposed to be comedies to laugh at. I laugh at different shit, so... When I want to laugh, I watched the first half up to the helicopter scene of Full Metal Jacket. Can't stop laughing. So
I concur. And then I think it's a fantastic film. I was enthralled. I was engaged. It's a good movie. I'm interested. So I'm actually going to come in. I'm just going to piggyback off IMDb, and I'll go higher than both of you because I still think Kubrick's a master at work here. And I'm jumping on the Kubrickian train, choo-choo, whatever. It is what it is. You can battle me all day, but I'll go with an 8.3, just like IMDb. I'm going to go an 8.3. Me love you long time. So
you guys know that was sampled in a rap song back
oh,
in
yeah.
the 90s?
Oh, yeah. Okay. Was it Two Live Crew? Yeah, yeah. Yep. Yep. I follow hip-hop. I'm a gangster, boy. I like hip-hop.
The only hip hop I listened to was Tone Loc. Just saying.
You like the classics, the 80s,
the funky Cold Medina.
Yep. So yep. I like the classic too. one thing. So we got this is Full Metal Jacket, 1987 war drama by Stanley Kubrick. And one thing I want to say before we bounce out here, James, thank you. In all the turmoil of very serious talk, because it's a war movie, thanks for bringing Harry Hamlin, Perseus, into this with the Medusa Clash of the Titans reference. Nice job.
Yeah, I thought I'd bring some levity to it.
Thank you. That's what I enjoy that.
Yeah.
So this is Gabe Allen and special guest James for the Tame Aperture podcast. Go check us out at tameaperture.com. We're also streaming on all media platforms, including YouTube, Spotify, iTunes. Go have a listen to our previous episodes and jump in with suggestions on future episodes. Until next time, everybody, signing off, Tame Aperture. Peace.
The Tame Aperture podcast is produced by Dutch Angle Pictures in association with Studio B Productions. Listen, watch, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Google Play, Spotify, and YouTube.